So a statement that I'm supposed to read before we start. So these events are being recorded and will be live on the iQuiz YouTube channel. For bandwidth purposes, we would like to request you keep your microphone and video off until the end. Should you have any questions during the presentation, I'll watch the chat box and we'll interrupt the presenter at the appropriate time. Otherwise, please feel free to ask your questions following the presentation. Thank you. Okay, so today it's our pleasure to have John Teufel joining us. So John is an experimental physicist in the Applied Physics Division at NIST Boulder. So he did his PhD at Yale in the group of Rob Sholkoff. And then after that, he went directly to Boulder where he did a postdoc with Conrad Leonard at JOA and the physics department in Boulder. And since then, he's been with the Advanced Microwave Photonics Group at NIST. So he's a project leader in that group, and he uses the tools of nano fabrication and precision microwave measurement at cryogenic temperatures to explore the quantum behavior of macroscopic systems. And this can even include mechanical degrees of freedom, such as the sound that he's going to tell us about today. So please welcome John, and John, please go ahead.
Great. Well, thank you very much for the invitation and the opportunity to speak. I'm learning about seminar series that I didn't know existed that look like beautiful things. So as the introduction said, my name is John Teufel. This work is work that's done in our labs at NIST, and it's a collaboration between our experimental team and the theory team at NIST. And really what we're trying to do is tackle some of the science and metrology of entanglement, both pushing towards useful technology and fundamental understanding of the science. So the kind of overly sexy artist rendition picture here I have on my title slide is trying to capture the idea of entanglement and how you actually measure it. And these pictures of these bongo drums somehow twisted, yet their shadows are not, as going back to the allegory of Plato's cave, where all we can really look at are the shadows. And the shadows are very much at the heart of real tomography in every sense of the word. You take snapshots over and over of what's going on, and from that, that's how you tell what's going on in the quantum world. So this work, if I can get my slides to advance. There we go. This work was recently published in Science earlier this year, and this is what I'm going to focus most of the talk. Just as an outline, I'm going to walk you through kind of a history of optomechanics and electromechanics, talk about some of our latest research and specifically the entanglement, and then push forward to some other quantum technology that we're working on at NIST. Before I start, I want to say that this particular experiment was the blood, sweat, and tears of a former postdoc, Shlomi Kotler. He's now at the Hebrew University. And so if you're interested in these things, please feel free to reach out to myself or to him. So in the science of entanglement, when I've begun presenting to this public, some of the first things that you get are hits on social media. And sometimes social media does quite well. Here's a little blurb that appeared on Reddit talking about bizarre effects in the quantum world as you push towards direct evidence of measuring things. What you also get on social media is very humbling things. So for example, one of my favorite comments that followed right after this nice blurb was, do you guys just put the word quantum in front of everything? And I thought for a quantum seminar, that's not only appropriate. My favorite part is not just this comment, but actually the response of Big Mike 420, who said quantum yes. So with the quantum yes, I'm going to throw the word quantum in front of everything and walk you through some of our macroscopic mechanical measurements we did in our lab. So as I said, just a brief outline, we're going to introduce mechanics as an emerging quantum technology, go to the physics of how we measure and couple to mechanical degrees of freedom, and some of our recent measurements on really doing high fidelity metrology and tomography of entangled states of motion. So I work in the Advanced Microwave Photonics Group. This is a group of many PIs, more than just myself, specifically Joe Amentado and Ray Simmons. And together we work on a number of things. The technology is very much like many labs, both at your university and throughout the world are doing. It's dill fridges and superconducting circuits and microwaves. And so in this genre, we do a lot with superconducting qubits. Namely, we have recent work on doing very fast, high fidelity parametric gates between qubits. We also develop Josephson technology. And here you should have in mind Josephson parametric amplifiers, nearly quantum limited amplifiers for measuring in the microwave domain. But more recently, we've been using them to go beyond, to make things like parametric circulators without using magnetic fields, and to combine all these tools to make directional amplifiers or other kind of hybrid quantum technology. And the last piece is really my bread and butter, the things I'll talk about most of the talk today, and that's the quantum mechanics, where you have to put the quotes around the mechanics. But these are really MEMS circuits done with nanolithography and kind of pushing to use the techniques that we've stolen from superconducting qubits and parametric amplifiers and apply them to these MEMS-like devices. So here's a picture of one of our MEMS drums. You'll note the scale bar down at the bottom. This is a false color ASTM image. On one hand, depending on which audience I'm going to, I will tout how nano this is or how macroscopic it is. The truth is, it is what it is. These are drums of about 20 microns in diameter. They have a fundamental vibrational mode. They're kind of suspended around this perimeter here. So they vibrate up and down like that of a taut membrane in the kind of tens of megahertz regimes. Now, what is desirable about these sort of systems as a quantum technology? What do you like about it? And part of what we like about it is the same thing that mechanics serves in classical technology. You have compact, high Q harmonic oscillators. They have enormous dynamic range and linearity, and that linearity can be a pro or a con. I will talk about that as I go throughout this. From a fundamental physics perspective, unlike other types of electromagnetic resonators, they have mass, and that can have implications for really understanding quantum physics as it goes forward. And I've written down there also the idea of universal. And that's the idea that, well, you can figure out how to couple almost anything to the motion of a drum. So one of the main roles of these mechanical systems is as an intermediary, getting between two disparate quantum technologies. Now, just to compare and contrast what I mean by compact, here's a picture from CERN in 1966 of what a 20 megahertz electrical resonator would look like if you made a kind of lambda over two pillbox resonator. And most of what you're seeing there is just the difference between the speed of light and the speed of sound. There's roughly four orders of magnitude that changes a lambda over two resonator at 10 megahertz from kind of the meter scale to the 10 micron scale. One of the other beautiful things, and one of these ideas inherent to quantum technology, is that you want them to be as isolated as humanly possible when you want, and couple to them as strong as possible when you want to couple to them. And with these mechanical systems, they're very intrinsically high Q. They have natural line widths of order a couple of hertz. But what we can do with parametric coupling that I'll explain throughout this talk is take this very narrow line width that you see in this EIT-like picture, and we can actually damp the motion, and we can make this drum go from Q of a million to Q of one. We can make our dynamics happen on the second scale or on the microsecond scale. And that kind of dynamic range in time scales is always a useful resource. Now, one of the things you have to think about in these mechanical systems is how do you measure or what level are the quantum fluctuations in these devices? From quantum mechanics 101, you can write down the zero point motion of a mechanical harmonic oscillator. It's characterized by fundamental constants, just the mass and the resonant frequency of the mode that you have. So if you think roughly about what scale is this, well, the canonical quantum mechanical system is that of trapped ions, where you have the motion of a single ion. And there, because of the ultra small mass, what you end up with is zero point motion that's relatively large on the scale of the devices I'll talk about. And that's nanometers of zero point motion. And so that's the scale that you need to be able to measure and interact. For our MEMS devices, these are masses that are maybe 100 picograms or something like 10 to the 14 atoms. And so the mass is much, much bigger, these many orders of magnitude. And in the square root, that gives you zero point motion now at the femtometer level. And while it sounds ridiculous, actually measuring and controlling at this kind of nuclear distance scale is something that is done not just in our lab, but in many of the labs throughout the world, in throughout the field of optomechanics. And just for scale, if you were to push to our everyday scale, that of really macroscopic, just something like a trampoline on the meter scale, you're talking about 10 to the minus 19 meters. And this is actually the scale that people like LIGO are measuring at. For our MEMS devices, as I said, I will talk about the macroscopic. What I mean is more macroscopic than an individual atom, but you can see the kind of log scale in between the really everyday scale and that of the atomic physics. So how do you measure at this level? Well, if you want to measure anything, not a bad way to start is just to bounce a laser off of it. So if I have some mechanical degree of freedom and I can bounce a laser off of it, and this mechanical degree of freedom is moving back harmonically at a frequency omega, the light coming back will get encoded with phase modulation. And that's just because this path length is moving back and forth. So as your boundary condition moves, you get a slight phase shift in the light. Now, if I look in the Fourier domain at the power spectrum, what I can see, pardon me, is the light is not all at the frequency that I shined it at. It's not just at the carrier frequency. There's in fact these phase modulation sidebands. So whatever language you like to think about this as phase modulation or kind of a type of Doppler radar, this is a way to measure very sensitively. Now we can of course do better. Instead of just making a single bounce, what you can make is a resonator. Here I've drawn a Fabry-Perot cavity where now the light bounces back and forth many, many times. And now you can see this transduction factor is really enhanced. You really take advantage of making a high Q or high finesse cavity, and you've really enhanced the transduction between motion and phase modulation. So this is a much bigger signal for you to measure. So that's the story kind of coming at this from an AMO or a quantum optics perspective. I'm a microwave guy, and what I want to explain to you today is you can do the exact analogous thing. Instead of using a Fabry-Perot, let's use a microwave inductor capacitor circuit. So again, this is an electrical inductor capacitor circuit for our devices, maybe around 10 gigahertz. If you make the top plate of the capacitor mechanically compliant, so it vibrates up and down, that vibrating capacitor will make your resonant frequency move back and forth and do exactly the same phase modulation that you have here. You also have this very same separation of time scales. The mechanics is vibrating at megahertz, the cavity is at gigahertz, and so you can really think about it in this same sideband picture. Now, I just talked about this as a sensitive way in which to measure, but this interaction also lets you do more. And the way you can think about it is, well, you don't get to measure for free. We all know in the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, there has to be some sort of back action. And that is physically just the radiation pressure of the photons carrying the light. And those photons can be optical photons in cavity optomechanics, or for our devices, our photons will be microwave photons. I want to say this is not just a nuisance. This is something we use all the time. This is how we do our quantum state preparation. And in fact, this is how we do our laser cooling. You can shine light in just the right way so that that scattering really prepares your mechanical degree of freedom in the quantum states that you want. And you can use your light as your pure quantum resource to really get into pure states from kind of the thermal world. So just a cartoon picture of how sideband cooling might work. If I have in purple kind of the density of states of a high Q cavity mode, well, what I showed you in the previous picture was driving with your optical carrier on resonance. But if you drive off resonance, a technique that's well known from AMO physics, you can look and see that some of these processes, like the upper sideband, can be resonantly enhanced, while the unwanted process can be kind of off-resonantly decoupled. And this ability to be in the so-called good cavity limit, to have a cavity whose line width is narrow compared to the separation, really lets you pick out whichever mechanism you want. Now, in this cartoon picture, I talked about it as heating and cooling. This is really Stokes and anti-Stokes sidebands. If a photon came out of your pump and got upconverted, it stole the energy from somewhere. And that energy is specifically from the mechanical degree of freedom. And likewise, you can do the converse. But this is the kind of regime that has enabled things like ground state cooling and really making sure that if you want to cool, you can cool. If you would want to heat, you can heat. You can think, why would I ever want to heat? But I will explain that more as I go throughout this talk. And again, I just want to call back, this is really work that's that's standing on the shoulders of giants. When I started here at NIST, I was down the hall from Dave Wineland and the trapped ion group. So the ability to measure data in the lab that looks very much like the seminal data that they took several decades ago, that's been a theme of my research. I mean, more specifically, if you talk about the Nobel Prize that was awarded to Dave Wineland and Serge Roche in 2012, these are really the hearts of the two things that I love. Using light to study quantum motion, as you do in trapped ions, or in the Haroche group, what many people forget is these seminal measurements in quantum optics, they're actually using microwave photons, photons at about 50 gigahertz. So combining these things is very much at the heart of what I'm interested in and what I'll talk about today. So what is this interaction Hamiltonian for quantum optomechanics? This zoo of devices that you see here on the left, these are all using the same simple radiation pressure Hamiltonian. And I've written it all fancy with the A's and A daggers. This is nothing to be afraid of. What you see here on the left, the B dagger plus B, that is just your displacement operator of your mechanical harmonic oscillator. And as I said, the constant out front is just set by that of the quantum motion, the 0-point scale of your mechanical harmonic oscillator. And so specifically, what we try hard to engineer in the lab is to make a mechanical degree of freedom that's as light and as floppy as possible, so it has as large 0-point motion as possible. If this part of the Hamiltonian is a displacement, then what's left on the left, that must be a force. And this is literally the radiation pressure force per photon. The A dagger A is the number of photons in the electromagnetic cavity. And this capital letter G, that constant, is just talking about how mechanically compliant your cavity is. How much does your cavity resonant frequency shift per unit motion? Now, in the end, we don't care about optimizing capital G or the 0-point motion. Like in many quantum technologies, it's the product of these two that gives us a coupling rate, a vacuum coupling rate, a G naught in our system. And engineering this G naught to be bigger and bigger has been very much a theme of this field. It's what lets you really couple more and more to the photons that are the coherent piece. You can do better cooling, better state preparation, and better measurements. So again, the two canonical systems you can think about, in the optical domain of Fabry-Perot cavity with a mechanically compliant mirror, or in our domain, you can take an inductor capacitor circuit and you can couple it out to a 50 ohm coax, either through some coupling capacitor or a coupling inductor like I've shown here. Same physics. How do I think about the parameters? Who's doing better? Who has a better G naught, or does one win? How do I think about this G naught in the simple Fabry-Perot cavity? Well, there aren't that many degrees of freedom in this system. If I have a Fabry-Perot cavity of just length L, I can write down the 0-point motion coupling. This 0-point motion coupling rate is just set by the overall frequency of the cavity, again, at optical frequencies. And then it's a ratio of length scales. It's the length of the cavity compared to the length of the 0-point motion. And that intuitively makes sense because you're basically, all you're doing is perturbing the length of this cavity, again, by the femtometer scale. Now in the microwave domain, there's something that looks very similar. I wanna highlight these types of circuits were thought about really by people like Berginsky way back in the 1980s in the context of LIGO. And thinking about before LIGO went to all lasers all the time, they were really pushing towards microwave transducers. Now the coupling looks very much similar. Again, the vacuum coupling rate is just set by the frequency of the cavity. Now, unfortunately, our cavities are now at 10 gigahertz instead of 200 terahertz. So that's a four order of magnitude kind of shot in the foot. Where we win it back is this characteristic length scale is now just the plate separation of your two capacitors. And very crucially, we can use lump circuit elements where this can be very, very sub wavelength. So most of what we do, most of what we spend all our time in the clean room is trying to fabricate one electrode tens of nanometers above this other electrode, and making this length scale as small as possible wins back a lot of what we lost to get our vacuum coupling. There's one last correction term here in the LC circuit, and that's what I'll call the participation ratio. And that's just to say, ideally, you want your mechanical degree of freedom to be the only capacitor in the circuit. If there's other stray capacitance, as there always is at some level, that will dilute down this participation ratio by some factor. What's nice with our very high impedance spiral inductors, we can really get this participation ratio quite close to unity. So now let's go to the spectral picture. Again, I want to highlight that we have two beautifully linear harmonic oscillators, a mechanical one and a cavity one, or an electromagnetic one. So the degrees of freedom I have are mechanical resonant frequency in line with, a cavity resonant frequency in line with. I'm going to take some pump in this system. And the nice thing about this pump is that this pump puts photons in the cavity. And if you take that nonlinear interaction Hamiltonian that I showed you and linearize it around a strong pump, what you can get is a parametrically enhanced coupling rate. And so this G that we can get is now dynamically controllable just through the strength of a pump. And this is the data that I showed you earlier, where you can take mechanics and make it completely decoupled from the cavity or super strongly coupled where it actually normal mode splits. This is through the parametrically enhanced interaction. So again, in our system, what you show is picture is you have some strong pump that will mediate some parametrically enhanced coupling rate. So how do I think about this as from the perspective of the mechanical oscillator? Well, I'm in mechanical mode. Intrinsically, I'm always looking out at some environment. And in fact, that acoustic environment is always going to look very, very thermal. And despite the fact we are going to stick these in dilution refrigerators and operate at tens of millikelvin, well, at 10 megahertz, 10 millikelvin still isn't enough to be in the quantum ground state. So the acoustic environment is really characterized by a thermal occupancy of a bath of maybe 10 to 100 quanta. And the mechanical mode is exchanging these quanta with the bath at its intrinsic coupling rate gamma. Now, what we want to make sure is that this bath temperature and the coupling rate really gives you a heating rate of the mechanics. This is both gamma sets the time scale for information to leave the mechanical mode, but this N thermal times gamma is the rate for incoherent thermal phonons to leak back into your mechanical mode. So even if you did prepare it in the ground state, it would start to rethermalize on roughly this time scale. And so having this particular hierarchy is just one way to say you need, if you want to prepare your mechanical mode in a pure ground state in the first place, it's got to be high enough Q so that when you damp it and cool it, you get to the ground state before your mode stops being a harmonic mode, before you run out of Q. And this is the same thing for sideband cooling, like I've shown, or any sort of active cooling, like feedback cooling that you might do in the lab. So that's just the mechanical degree of freedom. And again, the scale that I want you to have in mind is this thermal decoherence rate or this thermal decoherence time. And intrinsically, what you can see is if you make your mechanical mode higher or lower frequency, it doesn't actually help. In the Rayleigh-Jeans limit of the Bose-Einstein distribution, the mechanical frequency actually cancels out. And this thermal decoherence time, to make it better, the only thing you can do is make a higher Q mechanical mode or have a lower temperature bath that you operated in. So if you look around the field, if you were to ask, what if I want a mechanical degree of freedom to have a millisecond kind of quantum coherence time? Well, what can I do? Well, our drums, one of the things I say is that we both have to operate cryogenically and we get to operate cryogenically. And just for scale, if we operate at 10 millikelvin and Q of roughly a million that we have, this gives us this millisecond time scale. And again, that's a time scale that's relatively long for many quantum technologies. There's much other work in the field. There's beautiful work with silicon nitride membranes that are now pushing up to Qs of 10 to the 9. And what I want to say is what they can do is with three orders of magnitude larger Q, they could work nominally at three orders of magnitude larger temperature. And that's, in fact, some of the beautiful work that's being done. Some of the ultimate dreams is actually to have a room temperature technology, much like trapped ions. And in that vein, people are actually levitating nanospheres, really using optical tweezers. And there you can have Qs of order 10 to the 10 and operating near room temperature. And again, get back to this same kind of millisecond coherence time. So this is just to highlight again, mechanics as a nascent quantum technology, and specifically that of perhaps a quantum memory. So now back to our system. We had our mechanical mode coupled to its environment. We have a cavity mode that's also coupled to a same environment at the same temperature. But because this is at 10 gigahertz and 10 millikelvin, this environment at 10 millikelvin basically looks like zero occupancy. So I have a zero temperature bath and I have a hot bath. and I turn on some parametric beam splitter coupling between these two. Well, what does that look like? Well, I can think about this in two regimes. And the first regime I'll talk about is the so-called weak coupling regime. And by that, I mean that this coupling rate G is much smaller than kappa, the decay rate of the cavity. So in this picture, what I can picture is thermal quanta are constantly being loaded into the mechanics. The mechanics is trying to swap it around to the cavity, but before it can swap back to the mechanics, it's actually decaying out the cold environment. So from the perspective of the mechanics, it just gets this flow of a heating rate and an effective cooling rate. And this effective cooling rate or damping rate that I have is maybe a familiar 4G squared over kappa that you get in a weak coupling regime of harmonic oscillators or even cavity QED. And so this brings us to an important parameter. That's the quantum cooperativity. This is the coupling rate G normalized by the dissipation or decoherence of the system. So specifically, I'll take this coupling rate G and I'll normalize by the cavity decay rate kappa and the thermal decoherence rate over here. Getting into quantum cooperativity bigger than one is what will enable ground state cooling, entanglement, quantum measurement, a lot of the things that we're after in this system. So that's the so-called weak coupling regime. What would happen if I just keep turning up my parametric pump and make this vacuum, make this parametrically enhanced coupling rate larger and larger? Well, in that regime, you really enter the strong coupling regime. You have a mechanical mode at 10 megahertz, a microwave mode at 10 gigahertz, and these things will actually behave in the reference frame of the pump as if they are resonant with each other and exchanging information at a Rabi rate 2G. And if this is much, much faster than the decay rate of either side, then what you will see is really normal mode splitting and strong coupling. And it's in this regime that you can really think about doing things like pi pulsing the mechanical state into the cavity and then letting it leak out, or preparing the cavity in some interesting quantum state and really doing just a swap operation into the mechanical mode. One thing I will say is, unlike the James Cummings Hamiltonian where you have a two-level system, this Rabi rate really applies to the whole mode. It doesn't depend on whether this mode is photon or quanta by quanta, or if I have a mode with 1,000 quanta in it. These linear harmonic oscillators are effectively linearly coupled, and I can swap that entire state all in one fell swoop. So again, in the hierarchy of what we'd like this thermal decoherence rate to be the slowest rate in the problem. Kappa is our cooling, but ideally we'd want to make our G, our coupling, as big as humanly possible. And this last thing is just maybe an aside. In fact, you can get to regimes where G approaches the mechanical frequency itself. And that's actually onset of ultra strong coupling effects. It means for better or for worse, your rotating wave approximation starts to break down. And that's both a nuisance and interesting science. So what does this look like? I'm going to show you now some phase-based distributions of our two harmonic oscillators. Ideally, as I keep saying over and over, essentially we have a cold cavity starting off in its ground state. And I've shown kind of its X and Y quadratures in phase space. And I have a mechanical mode starting out with maybe 50 quanta in it. So it's in a thermal distribution. If I were to just turn on the beam splitter Hamiltonian by pumping at the difference frequency or pumping at the red sideband, my interaction in the linearized mode looks something like this, an A dagger B plus a B dagger A. And specifically, if I were to play the animation, what happens as a function of time is I will just coherently swap these states back and forth. Now, as I've contrived the system with no loss anywhere, you'll notice that energy is conserved. It's always in one mode or the other. And so I can freeze it at some point if I want to really say that the mechanics is cold. But really, to do real cooling, I actually need dissipation in the system. So let's see. So now if I add loss to my system, well, we just get that of damp swaps in our motion. And again, we start off with a cold cavity and a hot mechanics, and we can see that they are swapping their information. But in the long time limit, what you end up with is a pure state. Everything is pure. The cavity and the mechanics are both in their ground state, and the thermalness is really completely overwhelmed. And that is because the cooling rates have exceeded the thermal decoherence rates in your system. Now, quantum optics, in the linear kind of operations that you can have, The beam splitter is one of our go-tos, and we'll talk about that throughout the talk. There's also another side of the coin, and that's the idea of two-mode squeezing. And since these are parametrically coupled things, we don't have to pump at this different frequency and do a beam splitter interaction. We can actually pump at the sum frequency. And if we pump the sum frequency, as I alluded to in my talk, from the perspective of the mechanics, it looks like Stokes scattering. It looks like the mechanics is getting hotter and hotter. But from a quantum optics perspective, this isn't really heat. This is, in fact, the ideal two-mode squeezing Hamiltonian. The Hamiltonian that creates correlated photon-phonon pairs. So when I crack a pump photon and I energize the mechanics, I'm putting a highly correlated pair into the cavity system. And so this dual-mode squeezing interaction is exactly the thing that we're going to exploit for the entanglement, that's the heart of this talk, and for doing quantum measurements. And you can parameterize it in the same way. Now, if you adiabatically eliminate the cavity, it looks like an effective damping of the mechanics that's negative. So again, from just a classical energy perspective, it looks like it's gaining energy as a function of time. But really what I want to highlight is this is in fact the entangling rate. And this is what we want to do. So for example, if you were to start with a cold cavity and a hot mechanics and turn on your dual mode squeezing Hamiltonian, well, both of these modes are just getting hotter and hotter in time. In fact, if I showed you as a function of the interaction time, you'll recognize the very familiar cinches and coshes to amplification or the dual mode squeezing Hamiltonian. Rigorously, again, what I want to say is these modes are not hot. What you've done is you've entangled the mechanical mode, in fact, with the itinerant state of the microwave field leaving the cavity. And this photon-photon entanglement grows roughly exponential in time when you get into the limit of large G. So now onto the actual devices that we measure. Again, these are fabricated in the NIST clean room. These are beautiful fab recipes developed by Kat Chichek and Ray Simmons before I came to NIST. And the original ideas were actually to make the lowest loss capacitors you could have by removing all dielectrics. I had had a background in circuit optomechanics at that time and really wanted to just exploit these exquisite recipes that they have. So what we do is we start with a sapphire substrate. We put down a bottom electrode of aluminum. We put a sacrificial layer over our kind of drum electrode. We use silicon nitride, but you can use many things. And then we put a top layer of aluminum on top. We then go in and we etch out that sacrificial layer. That's part of what these holes are. And in the end is what you're left with is one electrode superconducting hovering above another one. These type of drums have been very good to us. In fact, we were able to show the first sideband cooling of any optomechanical system almost a decade ago. We've also since then done things like shown quantum state transfer or even initiating squeeze states of motion. We are at NIST, so near and dear to our hearts is also the ideas of quantum limits of measurements. And specifically, you can characterize these kinds of systems as force or displacement sensors. The overall scale that I want to say is you're at kind of the atto Newton per root hertz, or the maybe 10 atto meter per root hertz levels. These are numbers that on their own sound very small. What we get very excited about is, you know, the product of this kind of force times displacement sensitivity is of order H bar. And this is where you can tell that you're really approaching fundamental limits. Specifically, we've worked beyond linear measurements towards things like phonon number measurements using superconducting qubits. One of the things we're also interested in as a technology is that of microwave quantum networking. So we've made these kind of two electrode type drums that can couple to a cavity at one frequency and a cavity at number frequency. So in fact, we've demonstrated very efficient microwave frequency conversion, say from 4 to 8 gigahertz through a mechanical middleman. And you can do this with high efficiency and negligible added noise. And in fact, with more parametric pumps, what we can even do is make this work non-reciprocally as a non-reciprocal frequency translation stage. One of the last areas we've been pushing towards is that of quantum enhanced sensing. And in fact, what we've been doing is engineering quantum states of the microwave field, specifically squeeze states, and using that to illuminate our cavity optomechanics system. And in fact, what we've shown in some of our work is you can use it to do better displacement sensing, kind of the quantum enhanced sensing, and in fact, even better sideband cooling, even beating the resolved sideband limit of sideband cooling is something that you can surprisingly do by adding quantum resources such as squeeze states to your light field. So what about entanglement? Well, first of all, why is it useful? I will say quantum entanglement, as many people in this audience know, it's at the heart of many quantum communication protocols. It's the necessary resource for doing things like teleportation, and it also just gives you a larger Hilbert space for doing things like quantum enhanced sensing, perhaps adding more quantum variables to your system so that you might measure two of them perfectly. Well, why is it hard? As I've alluded to, again, to have good entanglement, you need two quantum systems that are intimately coupled to each other without seeing the hot environment that will decohere them, that will just collapse or trace out this entanglement. You need to control and measure at the zero point level. Pardon me. I'm going to take a sip of water. I'll let each of you think about quantum mechanics in your own life for a second. So as I said, as we move to bigger, massive systems, we have to really do the same kind of quantum control on a smaller and more delicate scale. And so not surprisingly, the way we're going to tackle entangling two mechanical modes is we're not going to have them interact directly, is we're going to use microwaves as our kind of quantum go-between that will make them talk to each other and also do the measurements. So again, what's nice about this is these mechanical degree of freedoms, they have nothing to do with each other initially until we begin to illuminate them with our microwave light. Then on demand, we can deterministically make them talk to each other and talk to each other at the quantum level. Now our protocol is a little bit weird. As I said, you have two drums in our system. We have a microwave cavity mode that we're going to use as our middleman. Both of these drums are talking to a hot thermal environment, and our lossy cavity, well, we strongly overcouple it so that most of the dissipation of the cavity mode is going to our measurement apparatus, going to our lowest noise microwave chain that we can make. So what is weird about this from a theory perspective is you have an intrinsically tripartite system. And I've told you how with our pumps, we can use dual mode squeezing or beam splitters to really get entanglement into this tripartite system. But one thing that's not obvious is if photons are constantly leaking out of the cavity to be measured, what you have to make sure is that that's not destroying the entanglement, or that this photons don't carry any which path information, that they don't know whether they came from drum one or drum two. So they preserve the indistinguishability that we know and love from entanglement protocols. So specifically, what we're going to do is apply a beam splitter between drum one and the cavity, apply a dual mode squeezing between drum, One gets a squeezing operation, one gets a beam splitter. And so you can imagine the squeezing operation is creating the coherent photon-phonon pairs, and the beam splitter is swapping those photons with the phonons of the other drum, effectively giving you a phonon-phonon coupling mechanism. Now, I want to say we're not the first working in the areas of entanglement. Some of the beautiful work, again, I'll go to trapped ions, doing full quantum control over two ions in two separate modes and separate traps. This was, I assumed, had been done in the early 80s or 90s, but this is actually only done within a little over the past decade. And again, it's just harder to get control of that degree of freedom. More recently, there's been work both in Finland and at Delft, making macroscopic systems. And both of these are beautiful measurements, really showing some of the first things that you want. Specifically, the microwave devices really showed deterministic entanglement. And the Groblocker experiments really showed you can do a high fidelity measurement doing click detectors. Ideally, what we were after from the start is the Venn diagram at the intersection of these three. Do something that's macroscopic, deterministic, with the ability to do high fidelity tomography without noise subtraction or inference. So here's our device. Again, we're going to make an inductor capacitor circuit. The spiral is just about a 10 nanohenry superconducting inductor. And now we're going to resonate not just with one drum, but two. These are going to be our two Alice and Bob in our picture. We're going to inductively couple both to our microwave ports and to our detection mechanisms. You can notice that these drums look a little funny. We made these shapes oblong on perfect purpose, as my colleague likes to refer to them, as the hamburger and hot dog mode. Basically, what you can see is by making the counter electrode live under only half of the mode, we can couple strongly to one even odd mode in one drum and the other even odd mode in the other drum. This lets us unambiguously determine which drum is which and which drum we're coupling to at any one point. And again, these two modes are very far from each other. Again, they're megahertz apart. So this mode is vibrating millions of line widths away from this mode. So there really is completely negligible interaction of these two things directly mechanically, and they will only know each other through the pumps. So how do you measure these circuits? Again, these types of circuit diagrams are the same as ubiquitous throughout the superconducting qubit community. We're gonna take pumps at room temperature, microwave synthesizers. We're gonna heavily filter and attenuate and go into our Dill fridge. So we get pure coherent states at the bottom of our dilution refrigerator. In this cartoon, I'm showing a directional coupler, which couples the pump off of our dispersive device. That pump is reflected, comes out through amplifier chains, and we measure and demodulate at room temperature. Now, as people also know, even using state-of-the-art cryogenic hemp amplifiers that were developed in the fields of radio astronomy, things done at Caltech and JPL, these are beautiful semiconductor devices, but they're far from quantum limited. They add a noise of maybe tens or hundreds of quanta, or in terms of efficiencies of 1% or less. Now there's of course a way around it. These are things that we've developed both in our lab and other groups, and that's to put preamplifiers in your system. And just like when you're trying to listen to your beautiful old school turntable or a guitar, you don't go directly into a power amplifier. You put a delicate preamplifier as close to the device as possible. And these Josephson parametric amplifiers, here I've showed a circuit where we actually do two of them. You can take your delicate microwave signal, it can reflect off of a Josephson parametric amplifier, come out with quantum limited gain, go to another gain, and then up through your last of your receiver chain. And in the end, this whole thing becomes your effective receiver that can be very close to the fundamental quantum limits. Here's a picture of some of the devices. These are things we fab using our niobium trilayer technology with simple modulated squids. And this is more of an advertisement of things we do and things that we collaborate with people to offer these kind of package products. And what's nice are these are have a bandwidth that has maybe tens or hundreds of megahertz, but it's entirely tunable over an octave band. So if your device is at 6 gigahertz, you tune it with a DC flux to exactly where you want, and you pump it to get gain kind of at the 20 dB level on demand. That's great and beautiful. What's the drawback? What's the problem? Well, one of the main problems is unlike qubit systems, we have very, very strong pumps. So in fact, our optomechanical pump tone that we apply is not just a couple of quanta in the cavity. This is thousands or millions of quanta in the cavity. And that gives you microwave powers that are actually too high for the Josephson parametric amplifier to handle. So just this coherent pump would saturate and drive nonlinear your Josephson parametric amplifier. And one way around it that we've been doing for quite some time now is to inject a cancellation tone that interferes. So you send one tone in that interacts with your mechanics. You now have this strong pump with its delicate sidebands. You interfere that with a copy of that same coherent tone that will destructively interfere and cancel that carrier, now making it amenable to JPAs. This is something you can do. It's a little tedious and a little hard to set up, and we're always kind of pushing the limits. And one of the things that we are going to use in this work is actually to use the optomechanical circuit itself as its own parametric amplifier and skip the Josephson amplifier altogether and skip all the complexity of pump cancellation. So I won't go into detail, but essentially, as I mentioned before, the dual mode squeezing interactions is an interaction where you can take mechanical quanta and you can amplify them into your cavity field. So again, just by at the end of our protocol, using some blue sideband pumps or some frequency pumps, we can get an amplified signal coming out of the mechanical mode that's robust to loss before you get to your hemp amplifier. So this is what the device looks like. Again, most of this stuff is experiments of my lab mates at the base of a dilution refrigerator. This little circuit box here with one SMA connector, that's our entangling circuit operating in a blue force to cryostat at about 10 millikelvin. And our protocol, we're going to use a combination of frequency and time domain multiplexing. We're going to do a pulse to cool both mechanical modes close to their ground state. We're then going to apply a short time and strong entanglement pulse to create the correlations between our two drums. Then we're going to try a simultaneous readout. We're going to simultaneously read out the position and momentum of drum one and drum two. And in a single shot of this protocol, we're going to acquire all four quantum variables of our device. Again, position and momentum and position and momentum. Then we'll apply a reset because our mechanics, if we just left them alone, would take way too long to just get back to their nice ground state. And then we're going to do this over and over and build up statistics and histograms so that we can do the quantum inference and the full tomography here by, again, doing single shot measurements of our four quantum variables. Here's a picture of what those kind of protocols look like in the frequency and time domain. It's a little bit complex to look at. This is the frequency in the reference frame of the cavity. So again, applying a pump at zero would be on resonance with the cavity. And you can see most of what we're doing is we're applying pumps at the red or blue sidebands of drum one or drum two. So as I said, we do a cooling pulse to simultaneously get both drums in their ground state, a very short for us is kind of 10 microsecond entangling pulse. And then we do these blue sidebands to simultaneously read out and amplify both drums into our microwave field. So what does entanglement look like in theory? What I show here are the two-dimensional histograms, and this is just theory on the left and the right. And what you have is a movie that I somehow can't stop playing. You start with a very cold state on the left and a cold state on the right. And here are the shadows. These are just the projections of your histogram in the X and Y quadrature. So again, if I were to play it again, when I turn on the entanglement, I take two things that start off very, very cold, points in the phase space distribution. And from the perspective of drum one, it looks hot. From the perspective of drum two, it gets hot. How do you tell that these things are not really hot? How do you tell that this is not just a lot of entropy, but really there are correlations? And now what you can do is you can actually look at the cross correlations. Don't look at the position of drum one compared to the momentum of drum one, but look at the position of one compared to the position of the other. And now in the cross correlation, you can see these hallmark features of dual mode squeezing interactions. You can see these ellipses where there is a particular correlation and anti-correlation in position and momentum. And that is in fact what entanglement means in this continuous variable sense. If drum one is over here, we know that drum two very much must be over here. And in fact, we can make that inference better than zero point fluctuation would allow us to do. What I want to highlight, the other thing we should also remember with canonical entanglement is it's not that drum one was over here and drum two was over here. This did not happen until we measure it. When we measured it, we collapsed drum one over here and we know the position of the other device. And this action at the distance is this is both what's spooky and powerful about entanglement protocols. So that's the theory. What do we actually see in the lab? Well, again, this is a movie of the data. These are histograms of thousands of single shot measurements. This is the histogram of drum one. This is the histogram of drum two. And what we're very excited to see is as we run our entanglement protocol longer and longer, we in fact do this dual mode squeezing. We can see this elliptical shape coming out here. And this is the smoking gun of entanglement. The fact that this is elliptical is saying that this drum definitely knows about this other drum. And the million dollar question is, well, how do you know if this is really quantum or just kind of cute classical correlations? Before I get too much into that answer, I'll just say that this full state tomography is in fact in the toolkit for what we want for mechanical elements, not just for entanglement, but as we push to more quantum states. And so in fact, what we can compare is our fiducial measurement, where both drums are prepared very cold, very close to their ground state. And now the drums themselves look cold, but all the cross correlations look cold. From a density matrix perspective, it looks just like nice cold on diagonal elements with nothing off diagonal going on. If we entangle and then measure, again, our histograms have all gotten larger. We see our two drums look hot, but you have these cross correlations. And in the density matrix, that's what gives you these beautiful off diagonal elements. I want to call your attention again, unlike two level systems, the dimension of your Hilbert space, these are continuous variables. So these are tens of quanta in each of these matrix elements and entries. And what is really nice is these off diagonal elements are basically equal and opposite. And that's a sign that's very encouraging that this might be a pure interaction. So what does this look like in the time domain as a function of our entanglement protocol? Well, if we just had a red and a blue pulse that had nothing to do with each other, we'd expect one drum to heat, the other to cool. But now when we have these two simultaneous things, the X's and the O's here are the data for drum one and drum two. And you can see both are growing in energy, no longer exponentially, but they're also not cooling. And what we're excited about is this is the theory line for the whole quantum theory. And so this is doing exactly what you want. It's not just the energy in the system that's doing what you want. You can look at the angle of this cross-correlation histogram and see if that also makes sense. And in fact, you can measure that this angle comes out not at 45 degrees, as you might expect for just usual two-mode squeezing, but for our protocol, this angle is non-trivial and evolves in time and agrees very well with theory. So with the last couple minutes of the talk, I really want to go into some of the hard parts about this, and that is really the entanglement metrology. So I told you we collect all this data. We have this whole matrix of data of the four coordinates of our system, position and momentum of both drums. And in continuous variables, there's a protocol, notice the Simon-Dwan criterion, that will tell you what to do with all this information in order to know whether your system is in fact separable or entangled. Now, technically, if you want to go into detail, you can take the minimum symplectic eigenvalue of the partial transpose of the covariance matrix. I've learned to say all that, but no one should ever try to say that out loud. Roughly speaking, what you're looking at are these cross-correlation elements and asking, are these things correlated better than a half? Where again, this half is basically the scale of vacuum fluctuations of your system. If this minimum symplectic eigenvalue is bigger than a half, well, your system is correlated, but it could be explained classically. If it's below this, then and only then you have entanglement. So these are the data that we measured. This is what we find. Again, this line at one half, this is the entanglement threshold bar. You can see for very short times of the entanglement, our drum is not starting perfectly cold. So it's actually getting closer and closer to this boundary. And right around 5 microseconds of entanglement protocol, we in fact go below this bound. This is a direct measurement of entanglement directly at the measured output variables without noise subtraction. And something we, including myself, have resorted to in the past, noise subtraction as a way just to infer the state. What we would really like in the end is not just to generate the entanglement, but really have it there as a pure resource to distribute, to do interesting things like tomography. The other thing that we spent a lot of time in this work are really these error bars that we put on this. This is the scatter of this device that we have here. And I'll talk about that a little bit in one more slide. Even though we plot this measurement well below the bound, we can see entanglement without noise subtraction. We can know the measurement efficiency of our clever techniques, and we can take back out what is the fault of just the fact that we chose to measure four variables and we didn't do it quite perfectly. If we do that, we can now make the inference of how pure was that entangled state. And for that device, for these measurements, we showed an entanglement of greater than 4 dB. And again, part of what we spent a lot of time collaborating with our theory collaborators on are these error bars. It's not just that we acquired enough statistics to know that we have this statistical uncertainty, but really the systematics, really doing the bootstrapping and the error analysis of these continuous variable systems. Roughly speaking, if I misinterpret exactly where vacuum is, I can very easily, very fragilely misinterpret my entanglement. So those protocols are what we spend a lot of time and effort on. I think because I've seemed to have babbled on quite a bit, I might stop here and make sure I have time for questions. I will just skip ahead for a second to my conclusion slide and take questions as we move forward. This is work that was done in the Advanced Microwave Photonics group. Shlomi Kotler is now at the Hebrew University, really spearheaded these things. Brad Hauer is the current postdoc. I want to highlight, if anybody's interested in anything I talked about or climbing or hiking in Boulder, please reach out to me for postdocs. We have very enticing things like NRC postdoc fellowships for US citizens, and we're always interested in it and good and useful scientists like are in the audience today. So with that, I'll stop there and thank you for your time.
All right, great. Thanks, John, for a wonderful talk. There were no questions that popped up in the chat during the talk, but anyone that has questions now, please feel free to turn on your cameras and just voice your question.
I have a question, Maurice Junge. I'm actually more on the theory side, but I was worried when you showed us this cancellation thing, whether that destroys entanglement. I mean, I know it's necessary for your apparatus in order not to destroy it. I understand why you're putting it, but does it change the A and B independence, entanglement perspective?
It doesn't, but it's not at all obvious why it doesn't, or okay. That is a perfectly appropriate question. Trying to go to a slide. Basically, the quantum variables, the A daggers and the Bs, are describing Fourier frequencies on resonance with the cavity over here. And our pump cancellation is really just in a narrow band. So these are spectrally resolved, and it's a little bit ambiguous. I should have labels on my photons of who's what and who's where, but that separation in frequency is what allows you to do cancellation over here and keep your delicate quantum state over here.
Great.
Any other questions? Maybe I'll ask kind of a naive question. So this beautiful entanglement that you showed, that's kind of between continuous variables, as you mentioned, position and momentum. Is there kind of a version of that where you can use like Fock states, like phonon occupation in the crystals, something like that, discrete picture?
Absolutely. So I would say optomechanics, for better or for worse, we tend to have the linear interactions. So continuous variables is the natural basis. If you have either a two-level system in your system or single photon sources, you can use drums to do discrete variables. And in fact, in the Delft experiments, what they did is they did click measurements to collapse these into single photon Fock states. And so what they showed were really discrete variables. And you know, I think the only drawbacks there is they had to do it in a heralded probabilistic sense. But what they got from that is they got beyond Gaussian states. They were doing kind of some of these Fock state encoding.
Okay. Very cool. One other maybe quick question. So I know there's a lot of activity now in doing like phononic crystals and really trying to turn off the environment. And people, I think, have recently, like Oscar and folks, have gotten to like second coherence time. Is that kind of compatible with your circuits and your technology, or would that be useful to have longer coherence?
The answer is always yes. But I will show like here's a picture of a two-dimensional phononic crystal. And it really helped because these things, they didn't realize how high Q they were. It was really radiating out. Same thing in the Oscar Painter one-dimensional times. They did their naive expectations. They thought their phononic shield was plenty. And then they added more shields and found their Qs could keep going through the roof. for our devices, I confess, we don't really know why we're stuck at Q of a million. I don't think the dominant loss is radiation out into the substrate. You have natural things like Kapitza boundary resistances that it doesn't naturally radiate well into the substrate. Patterning shields into the substrate are things we're thinking about. There's been some recent work kind of making an electromechanic device by metallizing a silicon nitride membrane, and they've been able to get Qs up more toward 10 to the 9. These are things we're always excited about. What's hard, at least in the electromechanics, is those things you often trade off some of the coupling or things you have to make sacrifices to get that high Q about your circuit. But this is absolutely at the forefront of the research, is how to have your cake and eat it too.
Okay, great. Thanks a lot. Let's see. I'm being told we have a question on YouTube. I think Kelly is trying to put it. Oh, here it is. Okay. Since your membranes are macroscopic, are all the atoms that constitute the membrane forming some kind of a phonon BEC?
I think the answer is no. And it's really weird. I've spent too much time trying to think about this. And on certain days, it makes perfect sense. And certain days, it doesn't. Just to be very, very clear, the thing that we are controlling is a center of mass degree of freedom. And so there's a very particular degree of freedom that's the center of mass of this kind of 100 nanometer thick thing with all of its atoms that aren't in some beautiful crystal. It's just some chunk of mass. The thing about it is moving up and down together. And I don't think it's fair to think of it as some Bose-Einstein condensation, but for that particular degree of freedom, that is exactly what we cool to the ground state and what we're coupling to and what we're using. I don't know whether that 100% answers the question, but again, these are things that are not trivial. And people really worry about this the most when they start to think about quantum gravity. What if I really put my drum in two places at once? How does the gravity of the device being here interact with the gravity of the device being here? And there people have to worry about, well, how do I think about the mass? Do I think about it as like some Jellium model of nuclear masses spaced around? Do I think of it as a continuum? These types of things give slightly different answers, and people are really trying to stick a pin in what seems like even simple questions.
All right, great. I think that's enough questions today. So.